Hello friends, welcome to another episode by Engineering Today, and we're back with some interesting updates. Let's begin our news with SpaceX's ambitious Starship project. SpaceX CEO Elon Musk has major plans regarding its Starship program. Musk, who unveiled Starship plans 4 years ago, believes that one day the spacecraft will take humans to Mars. At first, Musk announced that SpaceX would launch Starship to Mars by 2022, but later he said that it would take 2 more years. This type of delay is not a surprise, as SpaceX is taking its time to cover every milestone of Starship production and testing. They started working on Starship prototypes after Musk revealed his plans to launch Starship to Mars by 2022. During that time, SpaceX initially started developing Starship prototypes from carbon fiber composites, but later switched to steel as per Musk's instruction. Within the next 30 months, after the stated plan, SpaceX has built their spacious Starship factory in the Boca Chica, Texas site. The alien-looking giant factory can produce one fully assembled Starship within a month. In the meantime, SpaceX has carried out numerous fire tests of several full-scale Raptor engines. 8 high-altitude flights of fully assembled Starship prototypes. SpaceX has also bagged their achievement of launching full-size Starship for a high-altitude test with successful landing. For the interplanetary launches, now especially considering on Mars, the most efficient trajectories to maximize payload capacity are only slated for some weeks, which comes once in every 2 years. Thus, delay in a launching Starship to Mars by 1 year will have to wait for 2 years for the next launch opportunity. If SpaceX makes Starship space-ready by 2023, then they'll have to wait for late 2024 to get the most appropriate trajectory opened. Apart from the sadness of delays, SpaceX will get an ample time of nearly 3 years to ensure that Starship is technically ready. And they'll also get the time to make Starship more reliable for distant missions on Mars, securing the landing on Mars, and a way for designing and building the cargo for Mars. SpaceX, with their latest successful series of high-altitude test flights, with one fully successful landing, has proved that Starship's belly flop and free-fall landing is suitable for planets that have atmospheres. Orbital or suborbital, both forms of re-entry into Earth and other planets' atmosphere, will generate a huge amount of heat. Thus, Starship, being the largest vehicle made ever, will have the largest heat shield than any spacecraft ever built. SpaceX is going through the procedures of designing and building heat shields. Re-entry from geostationary transfer orbit, lunar orbit, or Martian orbit will put much more strain on Starship than the low Earth orbit. So SpaceX will need some time to devote for further testing of their next-gen ceramic heat shields and steel flaps to ensure that they are reliable enough to face extreme velocity and harsh atmospheric conditions. As several successful projects come through numerous failures, if the 2024 target is also delayed, then SpaceX will have the next opportunity to launch Starship by 2026. By that time, SpaceX may develop a system which has a capability to find ice and store it in the Martian surface, then using that ice to make cryogenic liquid oxygen and methane with adequate storing. SpaceX will also have to develop a technology for keeping the huge amount of cryogenic liquid propellant at the perfect temperatures for a longer period of time in various conditions. Thus, Starship will have enough technical work revolving it to Mars. Let's move to the next segment based on Musk's cloud partnership with Google. SpaceX is ready to install ground stations in Google data centers for its Starlink broadband satellites. On Tuesday, Google announced a cloud partnership with Musk's company, SpaceX. The reason behind this partnership is to provide Google Internet services and its application to customers through SpaceX's Starlink satellite. After adding SpaceX ground stations, Google Cloud Unit will be able to reach customers with nearby cell towers. Thomas Kurian, CEO of Google Cloud Unit, stated in a tweet, "Proud to bring SpaceX's 1,500-plus Starlink satellites, together with Google Cloud's infrastructure, to provide the world's business with broader connectivity to our fast, secure cloud network." Every month, SpaceX keeps adding a new batch of Starlink satellites to low Earth orbit. It's becoming one of the most powerful broadband services in the world. Having Starlink constellation as an ally will help Google to compete against Amazon and Microsoft's cloud computing segment. Now, what will it do for SpaceX? In return, Starlink customers can experience Google's infrastructure and capabilities with secure connections. Urs Holzel, Senior Vice President of Infrastructure at Google Cloud, stated, "Applications and services running in the cloud can be transformative for organizations, whether they're operating in a highly networked or remote environment. We are delighted to partner with SpaceX to ensure that organizations with distributed footprints have seamless, secure, and fast access to the critical applications and services they need to keep their teams up and running," he added. This is all for SpaceX. Let's move to the next segment based on China. China made history by becoming the second nation to land its rover on the Red Planet. On Friday, May 14th, China's solar-powered rover Zhurong of the Tianwen-1 mission touched down on Martian ground at about 7:11 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time. The Tianwen-1 mission, which was launched back in July 2020, reached Mars's orbit in February. After circling around Mars for more than 3 months, the Tianwen-1 lander entered the Martian atmosphere on Friday. About 9 minutes later, the Zhurong rover parachuted down on the dunes of southern Utopia Planitia region. A heat shield protected the spacecraft during landing. China Global Television Network and researchers of Macau University of Science and Technology in China later announced the news of Zhurong's landing. The name Zhurong comes after an ancient fire god in Chinese mythology. Now it became the first Chinese rover to land on Mars. The rover will spend 90 days on the Red Planet, which is equal to 93 Earth days, by exploring and analyzing the local area, climate, magnetic field, and subsurface. To do so, Zhurong has several scientific equipment, like laser-induced breakdown spectroscopy instrument to analyze surface elements and minerals, panoramic and multispectral images, a climate station, magnetometer, a ground-penetrating radar, etc. Combining the measurements of all the weather stations will help us to better understand the Martian climate and will undoubtedly bring new information and will also help us prepare for future human exploration," stated Maria Haita, a space engineer at the Finnish Meteorological Institute. Meanwhile, China is collaborating with Russia on an asteroid sample return mission, expected to be launched in 2024. Let's move to our last news based on the Space Force. On the 12th of May, General John Raymond, Chief of Space Operations, said that the U.S. Air Force desires to employ small radar satellites for tracking mobile objects on the Earth's surface. He also stated that the Space Force will help them in this matter. At the McAleese & Associates annual defense conference, Raymond said, "We're building a GMTI, Ground Moving Target Indicator, from space program. The U.S. Air Force presently uses bigger aircrafts for tracking mobile objects. Those are Joint Surveillance Target Attack Radar systems, which have radar sensors installed in them to segregate targets against the ground clutter. Joint Surveillance Target Attack Radar system needs a good number of crews to operate it. Due to its big size, it's easily targeted by enemy defense missiles, posing a serious threat to its crew." Nearly 3 years before, the Air Force Rapid Capabilities Office had pursued the project for using small-sized radar satellites for GMTI for tracking ground mobile objects. Raymond said that the Space Force and the Air Force are actively working on concepts for the deployment of GMTI satellites. GMTI from space is about doing the JSTARS mission without being tied to an airplane in a contested environment. He said the Space Force will work with the Air Force and the intelligence community in a complementary way, not competing. We'll leverage commercial more than we've done in the past. A Space Force representative said the space-based GMTI system will replace a portion of the JSTARS sensing capability. The space-based GMTI system will surpass the range limitations of current air platforms and will provide capabilities in contested and non-contested environments. This effort is another way to harness data from the space domain and can be further used, aiding the military with information. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe for more videos like this. Hit the like button if you find the video interesting, and kindly provide your valuable feedback in the comment section. This will help us to improve.